Recording.
I'll switch off my video and
it's okay. Turn it off. I'll just quickly introduce. You can turn your video on. So good evening, everyone. Welcome to this Journal Club series of Inspire. So we are trying to do some online sessions, inviting international speakers, and also we are promoting our colleagues back in India and here, those who are promoting, publishing their work and asking them to come up and present their work here. And we have two speakers today at our very first Journal Club, Dr. Javed Ahmed and Dr. Veer Raghavan. Just to briefly talk about them, Dr. Javed Ahmed is working as a neonatologist in WRC or Hamad Medical Corporation in Doha, Qatar. He's from Mumbai and he's quite enthusiastic researchers and I think he's been quite recently been productive in doing a lot of systematic reviews and meta-analysis. And this was one of the recent publication he had. And again, as a clinicians, a lot of us are, you know, having difficulty in sort of understanding this new modality of systematic reviews and meta-analysis called as network meta-analysis. So we thought, let's take an opportunity to, you know, talk about it. And Dr. Javed and Veera, Dr. Veera has published recently a network meta-analysis on postnatal corticosteroids. So we have invited both of them. Dr. Veera is from Andhra Pradesh. He's done his DM from Lady Harding Hospital in India. And then he was also working as a fellow in John Radcliffe, Oxford University Hospital for more than 2 years. And now he's working as a consultant neonatologist in Ankura Hospital for Women and Children in Hyderabad. He's our expert for network meta-analysis. I think he's published 5 or 6 of them in last 1 year. So Veera, you, we want this session to, you know, be more productive and we would all will like to learn from you and both of you how to do meta-analysis and how to interpret and how to translate it into a clinical practice. So without wasting much time, I'm handing over to both of you to talk and discuss this Journal Club. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kiran, for introducing. And thank you, Dr. Veera, for being here on a short notice. Frankly speaking, this was first time we did this network meta-analysis, and it is all Dr. Veera's efforts. And he basically taught us how to do it, how to understand network meta-analysis. So we'll start our session. This is about prevention of BPD, use of postnatal steroids. So as we all know, this one's again, it's freezed. Just one second. So as we all know, bronchopulmonary dysplasia is a common disorder we see in extremely low birth weight Elgan baby. And it is a risk of mortality as well as short and long-term morbidity. We all use postnatal steroid for prevention, extubation, and treatment of BPD. However, what time to start a steroid? What is the dose which is safe for the baby? And which is the best regime? And which is the best steroid available? Still is debatable. And there is always concern about neurodevelopmental outcome with the use of steroids. So here, this is the postnatal steroid chronicle in emoji form in 1980s when Cummings and all started using steroid that was very high dose steroid in the tune of 6 to 8 mg/kg distributed over a period of 4 to 5 weeks. And then people started using right, left, and center till in 2000 when Yale pointed out in his meta-analysis that early exposure of steroid may be detrimental for neurodevelopmental outcome. And then there came the Halliday's famous Cochrane review, which conclusively proved that early exposure of steroids can lead to neurodevelopmental impairment. In 2002, AAP and Canadian Pediatric Society came out with a joint statement and stopped use of postnatal steroid. Since then, a lot many things have changed in neonatology. Our preemie care and especially extreme preterm care have improved. Survival has improved, and people's perception has also changed. There are a lot many landmark trials, especially Waterberg trial, Primilog trial. That trial has come up with a long-term neurodevelopment follow-up. So in 2010, AAP has come up with a statement, and recently we have European Society and CPS guidelines in 2020, which are more optimistic. We'll briefly glance through this guidelines. So this is a 2010 AAP guideline where they have not endorsed any low dose or high dose steroid, however permitted the use of early hydrocortisone for a high risk population, especially those with a chorioamnionitis and ELVW baby. In 2019, European Consensus Guideline has come out with a, has proposed a short tapering dose of very low dose or low dose dexamethasone to facilitate extubation after 1 to 2 weeks. They have also allowed inhaled butoxenoid for a very high-risk babies. Remember, just the quality of evidence is high. However, the extent of recommendation is weak. And very recently, the CPS has come out with a guideline for the postnatal use of corticosteroids. This is 2020. Early steroids are strictly no. Hydrocortisone can be used, especially ELGANs less than 28 and chorioamnionitis baby in physiological doses. They have prohibited the use of early inhaled corticosteroids. After 7 days, inhaled corticosteroids can be used only in high-risk cases. However, the infant with a high risk of BPD, short course of dexamethasone in the dose of 0.15 to 0.2 mg per kg, tapered over 7 to 10 days can be used. However, they have especially pointed out that the titration is based on the illness severity is advised. So in summary, early steroid unanimously agreed that it's harmful, should not be used. Hydrocortisone can be used, especially in high-risk babies. Inhaled steroids can be used, may not be used, depending on which guidelines you are following. And after 1 week, low-dose dexamethasone is safe for high-risk babies. So neonatal community was quite divided between what to use steroid, not to use steroid. There are one group of people who are using steroid right, left, and center, irrespective of dose or risk stratification. And there was other people who were very much worried about cerebral palsy risk and are not using even if the child is stuck with on the ventilator. Then came the third group of people who thought that BPD itself is a risk factor for neurodevelopmental impairment, and it is safe to use, especially hydrocortisone in a high-risk population. So the pendulum is swinging, and I'll ask, this is a question to Dr. Veera. So with so many protocols and steroid preparation, how does a which guideline to follow, which steroid to use?
Thanks, Javed. Clinicians usually go by guidelines. So when guidelines themselves are contradictory, it's quite difficult to say how to use it. There are certain things that are quite clear when it comes to postnatal systemic corticosteroids. The first thing is, don't use it early. All the guidelines uniformly say so. Except for a network meta-analysis that was published in 2018 in our case, where a group of authors had evaluated early dexamethasone, and they concluded that early dexamethasone is safest and the most effective regimen. Though it was published in a very high impact journal, there were not that many takers, because guideline bodies, they go through a variety of things before they come on to their recommendation. So one thing we are clear, don't use it early. Now, second thing that has stayed uniform across guidelines is the use of low dose hydrocortisone in very high risk babies. This thing it's become a standard of practice in many Western countries, where we start low dose hydrocortisone at a dose of around 1 mg per kg per day on day one. And there are certain differing regimens. You either continue it for 12 days or you taper it over 9 days to 0.5 mg per kg per dose and then give it for another 3 days and stop. So these two things are quite clear. Now, where does the ambiguity arise? The ambiguity arises in relation to inhaled corticosteroids. You have the European guidelines which say you can use early inhaled corticosteroids, specifically inhaled butoxenoid. And you have the recent Canadian Pediatric Society recommendation which is a strong recommendation. It says that don't use inhaled botulinumtoxinA early in life. So you have a controversy related to that. The second one is dexamethasone. At least on one point, most of them have agreed. You can start as early as 8 days, 8 days of late. Previously, it used to be 14 or maybe even 21. If you see the DART study, the median age of starting steroids was around 23 days. So at least on that aspect, guidelines are quite clear. You can start as early as 8 days. How much to give over what? What is the cumulative dose that we can safely give? And for how many days we can divide it? These are all still a controversy. If you see, read the European guidelines very clearly, it's quite ambiguous. They say very short course over this many days. And if you see Canadian guidelines, they are a little bit more specific. So there were still controversies when we decided to do the paper. And we should thank Professor Charles Rower suggest us to do this paper, even when we thought doing another network meta-analysis within a span of 2 years might not be useful. He had suggested us to go ahead, and this paper has created lots of, has had lots of attention. So as of now, clinicians should go by their local regional guidelines, and Canadian Pediatric Society guidelines, which is the most recent, seem to be the most reasonable one based on recent available evidence. The American Academy of Pediatrics is on the verge of coming out with their guidelines. I was privy to a conversation with John Supancic, who is the main lead author for their guideline panel. So they would be out with a new American updated AAP's guideline, which will base many of its recommendations based on our paper as well. So as of now, go by Canadian Pediatric Society guidelines, which is the most recent and updated one.
Thank you, Dr. Veera. So we'll go to this paper. Dr. Veera is the lead author, and I was privileged to be one of the part of the team. This was published in 15 March 2021, JAMA Pediatric, and this has created lot much of buzz across the globe. So within 12 hours of Professor Charles tweeting about it, Abneo came out with a summary within 24 hours. And this is you can see all over the world, it has created a lot much of buzz, especially in North America, UK, Australia, as well as Asia. You can't see that China because Twitter is banned over there. And then evidence-based neonatology also came out with a special episode, a video podcast after 2 weeks. If you see the altmetric attention score, it is trending at 44, an all-time high, and came within 5% of research output ever published for the age group. So as we walk through this paper, we are going to assess a network meta-analysis also. We'll try to understand how network meta-analysis work. And Dr. Veera is here to help us in difficult conditions. So when you have, let's say, drug A compared with drug B, and you have, 10 RCT, you can see the efficacy. You can decide by doing pairwise meta-analysis. Now you have a drug A comparison with drug C, and let's say you have an 8 RCT, you can see the efficacy or effect, treatment effect, by direct pairwise meta-analysis. Now, if you want to find out what is the effect of B over C, there is no RCT. Here comes the network meta-analysis, where it will give you an indirect evidence what is the treatment effect of B over C. So here this is the usefulness of network meta-analysis. The principle is simple, mathematical, like if A is twice better than B and three times better than C, let's see. So what is the proportion of B over C? So it's simple mathematics, but it's not really that simple when it come out to be analysis and interpretation. So what happens when you have ultimately direct evidence also? So the indirect evidence is not discarded. It is included in the final evidence of B over C. Dr. Veera, you have anything to say here?
No, I think I'm sure the audience did understand what you tried to say.
Great, thank you. So this was Prospero registered trial. We tried to look into the primary outcome of BPD or mortality, which is combined outcome of mortality or BPD at 36 weeks. And we look into almost all the important secondary outcome, including intraventricular hemorrhage, cerebral palsy, neurodevelopmental outcome. So this is a little bit heavy slide. I'll go very slow. Just be patient. So here we divide the steroid into 14 interventions, systemic steroids followed by inhaled steroid. Systemic steroid we divided into based on timing. Early initiated steroids were totally out of question. So we started with moderately initiated, early initiated steroid, which is 8 to 14 days, and late initiated steroid, which is 2 weeks to 3 weeks. The low cumulative dose, medium cumulative dose, and high cumulative dose, which is less than 2 mg, 2 to 4 mg, and more than 4 mg per kg of total dexamethasone. So I'll repeat, moderately early is 8 to 14 days, and late initiated is 15 to 27 days. Low, medium, and high cumulative dose are 2 to 4, and more than 4 mg per kg of dexamethasone, respectively. Now, this acronyms a little bit look very difficult, but actually I'll try to simplify, and they are not that difficult when we start talking about them. MOLDX is moderately early initiated low dose dexamethasone. MOMDX, moderately early initiated medium dose dexamethasone, which is within after 1 week of life, 1 to 2 weeks of life, 2 to 4 mg per kg of systemic steroids. Moderately early initiated HD is high dose dexamethasone, which is more than 4 mg per kg of dexamethasone. Similarly, LALDX is late initiated low cumulative dose dexamethasone. LAMDX is late initiated medium cumulative dose dexamethasone. LASDX is late initiated high dose dexamethasone. Things are much easier here. ESC is early initiated hydrocortisone. LSC is late initiated hydrocortisone. EIBD is early initiated budesonide, early initiated beclomethasone, early initiated fluticasone, late initiated budesonide, late initiated beclomethasone, and this is ITB, is intratracheal budesonide, which is used as a vehicle for surfactant delivery. I hope it's clear. Now we have used only the RCT, and we graded it according to the grade handbook and risk of bias assessed by Cochrane guideline. This is Prisma flow. So initial search result were around 4,500, and we have to manually screen around 2,200 articles, and 62 articles were included for systematic review and meta-analysis. This is overview of ROB. Risk of bias assessment in the clinical trial. As you can see, majority of trials had some high risk or unclear risk of bias. Now, here, this is called as network plot. Network plot has nodes, which the size of the node indicate the number of participants in that group. So this placebo is the highest one. Now, this is ESC early hydrocortisone, the size is proportional to the number of the patient enrolled. Straight line indicate there is a direct comparison or RCT is available. The thickness of the line indicate the number of RCT in the included trial. So you can see ESC versus placebo had eight trials, which is thicker than LHC versus placebo, which is thinner as compared to this one. So this is graphical representation of network plot. This is a little bit heavy slide. Here we want to show the pairwise meta-analysis as well as indirect evidence from network meta-analysis, things which work. So early hydrocortisone is effective. Evidence from a direct is moderate. Early initiated fluticasone is effective. Intratracheal budesonide, LASDS is late high dose dexamethasone, moderately early initiated high dose dexamethasone, and moderately early initiated medium dose dexamethasone. They are effective. Here, I'd like to draw your attention towards the difference between direct and indirect evidence. Here it is, direct evidence is moderate, whereas indirect evidence is low. Similarly, this is same. So, Dr. Veera, I'll require your help. How do you interpret the evidence if there is a difference between direct and indirect estimates?
So, the quality of evidence might be differing between direct and indirect evidence. That is one of the important uses of a network meta-analysis. So, if you have a low quality evidence for indirect or direct, and you have a higher one for the other component, eventually it is the higher component that will be used as the final evidence. For example, in this slide of yours, you told moderate and low for moderate high dose dexamethasone.
Right.
So the final evidence will be moderate. So if people have any doubts regarding how to grade evidence for network meta-analysis, which is one of the toughest of the all the analysis, they can go and look at a video which is there in YouTube by Gordon Guyatt, one of the forefathers of designing grade for network meta-analysis. Very good explanation. I mean, he has, the video lasts for almost 1.5 hours, but it's quite justified if you can sit for 1.5 hours. So quality of evidence can vary between the direct and indirect evidence. That is the main point why we do network meta-analysis. Whenever you don't have direct comparisons between two drugs, then you go through the indirect evidence. When you have both, then you go by the evidence that is stronger. But what is more important is the point estimates, which is not depicted in the figure, but as per GRADE recommendations, you have to depict the direct and indirect evidence separately, the point estimates for them. And then you have to depict the network final network estimate. This is not shown in this figure because of some other reasons, which I don't want to go into. So those should not be varying. They should lie within the 95% CI of either of them. So you have a direct evidence that has an estimate that is way away from the indirect evidence. Then something called inconsistency creeps into your analysis. When you have inconsistency in a network meta-analysis, then your estimates are all doubtful. Though many of the renowned statisticians across the globe have tried to address this inconsistency through multiple ways, there is still no consensus. So when you have inconsistency, one easy way is to just downgrade the evidence. There are other approaches as well. So what is important more than the quality of evidence between direct and indirect is the effect estimates, the point estimates and the 95% CI of both. They both have to lie within their 95% CI. It should not be too much deviated from each other's point estimates. And which will be reflected in your statistical analysis as inconsistency. So once you have inconsistency, you are stuck. There are other methods by which you can avoid it. Once it happens, whatever you do is going to be a post-hoc intervention. So a priori, you try to avoid inconsistency. I'm very sure Javed would be telling about that later in the later slides. The second aspect is what is a combined estimate? It is very simple. You have two effect estimates from direct evidence and from indirect evidence, you combine it. So the final estimate will be a combination of direct and indirect evidence. So that is a combined estimate, which is depicted in this figure that Javed showed. The final estimate is a combination of estimates of direct and indirect evidence. So that is quite simple to understand. So just to put it succinctly, the quality of evidence might differ. It will differ. That is the point of doing a network meta-analysis. But the effect estimates, what are they? They should not be substantially different. Whatever you are getting from direct evidence should be similar to what you get from indirect evidence. If when they differ, then your network estimates are a suspect. So whenever you read a paper on network meta-analysis, always look at inconsistency assessment, whether the authors have done it or not. If they had followed PRISMA NMA extension framework, they would have definitely done it. But the earlier papers on network meta-analysis, many of them had not done this this aspect, which is the most important aspect in the network meta-analysis. Yes, Javed.
Thank you, Dr. Veera. Now, coming down to SUCRA plot, the most fascinating thing in NMA, the SUCRA, which is surface under cumulative ranking area curve. So SUCRA is just graphical representation of the effectivity or the ranking of the treatment. So this is the this is the curve with the maximum area, probably the number one treatment. This is the second curve with the maximum area, is the second ranking treatment. So this pink is MO-MDX, which is moderately early initiated, medium dose dexamethasone. And this one, brown one, is moderately high dose dexamethasone, moderately early initiated high dose dexamethasone. And the least effective is late hydrocortisone, which is the yellow one. So so the SUCRA value of MO-MDX is 0.91, which is indicated 91% of the time it's going to be successful. MO-SDS, which is moderately early initiated high dose dexamethasone, is 86% effective. Late initiated high dose dexamethasone is 0.76. And LSC, which is the least effective. So Dr. Veera, can you tell us more about SUCRA, why it is, how good or how bad it is, and how much we should rely clinically?
Yes. So SUCRA is one of the easiest thing to interpret and misinterpret as well. So whichever reviewer you sent a paper of network meta-analysis to review, and if he is very good in that aspect, first thing he will tell is, list out the fallacies of SUCRA in your methodology, so that readers don't misinterpret your findings. This graph is very easy to understand. The more the area under the graph, the higher will be the SUCRA rankings. So SUCRA rankings can be anywhere between 0 to 1 or 0 to 100%. Both are same. If you use percentage, it will be 0 to 100%. Otherwise, it will be, many of the papers report it from 0 to 1 as well. So the area under the curve matters. So if you see the x-axis, it is showing the probability of a particular intervention being ranked 1, 2, 3, 4, and till 15, because we have got 15 interventions. So probable, including placebo. So the probability of each intervention being ranked first or second or third will be plotted in this graph. For example, the topmost graph, this has got the highest probability of being ranked first, second, third, etc. And this the area under the curve, it's very similar to the ROC curve that we do for sensitivity, specificity, and all. So it's very simple. More the area under the curve, the better is the intervention. So they can have any value between 0 to 100%, and it does not indicate any, it does not correspond to any quantum of difference between those two interventions. It's just a point value. The higher the SUCRA, the better the intervention. Now, this should be interpreted very carefully. SUCRA should first be interpreted along with the quality of the evidence for that particular intervention. You have a very high SUCRA ranking intervention, but the quality or the certainty of evidence is very low or low for that particular intervention. And you have a second intervention which is ranked second in SUCRA, but the quality of evidence is moderate or high. As a clinician, you should go for the second intervention because the certainty of evidence. We have not gone into detail about what certainty or quality of evidence means. But higher the quality, the more confident are you that whatever your the effect estimate that you have got is closer to the true value. So that is the first thing I want to tell. Always read SUCRA with the certainty or the quality of evidence. Second thing, as nicely pointed out by Dr. Sovik in his EBNIO lecture, SUCRA does not take into account the 95% CI of each intervention for an outcome. It's just the point estimate that it looks at. So look at the 95% CI for all the interventions along with the SUCRA plot. You have an intervention that has got a very nice point estimate, very high relative risk reduction for an adverse outcome. But you see the 95% CI is crossing the line of no effect. And you have another intervention which has got a lesser relative risk reduction compared to this intervention, but the 95% CI is more precise, then go for the more precise one. This again will be reflected in your grade. If you have a more precise CI, your imprecision, the precision thing will be justified. So this will again be reflected in the grade. Overall, look at the grade along with SUCRA before you come into a conclusion. There is a very good example given by Gordon Gayatt himself regarding the use of different types of fluids, crystalloids, colloids, etc. in shock. So they got an intervention which had the highest SUCRA value, but the least certainty of evidence. And it was quite, I mean, that is a very good example where you can see how Sukra can be misinterpreted by a clinician. Past clinicians look at certainty of evidence as well, along with Sukra values. Okay, Javed?
Just, may I interrupt? I mean, we will do the questions at the end, but interesting question from Dr. Amit. Will placebo curve will always have the least area under curve in Sukra plot? Because it's a good observation that the gray line of the Sukra curve is, is it always that the placebo curve will be the least area under curve? Can we?
Yes, that's a very interesting question. I forgot to tell about that. Sukra curves can vary depending upon the outcome, whether it is a good outcome or an adverse outcome. So you have BPD or mortality, which is an adverse outcome. You will have chances of extubation, which is a good outcome. So you have to interpret, I mean, you have to, when you're giving the while giving the command to your software, which analyzes all these things, you have to specify which outcome you are mentioning. If an intervention results in a worse outcome compared to placebo, then the placebo might be ranking high. For example, you analyze early hydrocortisone with placebo for the outcome neurodevelopmental impairment, then your placebo will be ranking very high. So that's a very good question by the doctor. I mean, I forgot to tell you that. The Sukra values can vary based on interventions. So recently I read a network meta-analysis paper, which has come for review, where they have used another methodology, which incorporates both the Sukras of adverse and as well as good outcomes of a particular intervention, and comes to another final Sukra value. I don't know what which software they used, but based on the outcome, your placebo might be ranked even higher if the intervention is causing severe adverse effects. Does that clear, Kiran sir?
Yes, yes. You can. Yeah, we'll take remaining questions at the end.
So one more point to add, that Sukra is only a ranking. It does not take into account harm caused by it. So a treatment may be ranked very high. At the same time, it can cause harm. So it should not be considered. Now, this is again forest plot. So here, this is the line of no difference. This is the favor placebo, and this favor the intervention for primary outcome, which is bronchopulmonary dysplasia and mortality or mortality at 36 weeks. So we can see that ESC, early hydrocortisone, intratracheal budesonide, early initiated fluticasone, late high dose dexamethasone, moderately early initiated high dose dexamethasone, and moderately early initiated medium cumulative dose dexamethasone. These are the intervention which work for the primary outcome.
Yeah,
I'd like to draw your attention.
Javed?
Yes.
So when I told CI, that is confidence intervals. Whereas if you see in the diagram, you can see it as credible intervals.
Credible intervals.
So yes. So we have used a Bayesian approach for network meta-analysis. If you use a Bayesian approach, your results will be reported in credible intervals. You have a frequentist approach of doing network meta-analysis, when the final effect estimate will be reported as 95% CI, confidence interval. So there is a huge deal of difference between credible interval and confidence interval. And there are network meta-analysis, high quality network meta-analysis that have been done using frequentist approach as well. It purely depends upon person who is doing it. It's much easier to do. Just to give an example, a recent network meta-analysis published in archives on different modalities of surfactant administration, they had used a frequentist approach. When you evaluate a network meta-analysis, also see for the approach they have used, and to see what is the difference, to learn about the difference between a Bayesian approach and a frequentist approach, you can always search the net. It's quite extensive. Sorry, Javed, to interrupt. Because I was telling CICI, whereas we have used credible intervals in this analysis because we have used a Bayesian approach.
Thank you, Dr. Veera. Actually, I have also forgotten to talk about credibility interval, and thank you. Thank you for reminding me. Yeah. So we'll move ahead. So this is, again, I just want to draw your attention to the comparative group from pairwise meta-analysis of primary outcome. I want to draw your attention towards all the study on which this meta-analysis was based is done in a late 90s and early 2000, and the number of participants are very small. So, Dr. Veera, how do you, what do you infer from this one? The old study is almost 3 decades old and very small sample size.
So, this would be addressed in the grade evaluation, where you will first downgrade for imprecision because your sample size is quite low. You can also downgrade for indirectness. That is, indirectness means the population you are interested in is preterms who are cared for in 2020 or 21. And you are comparing with interventions that have been done in preterm newborns who were evaluated in the 90s and early 2000. So this would eventually be reflected in your grade. You can downgrade the evidence for indirectness because of the time interval between these studies. You can also downgrade the evidence for imprecision, which is basically reflective of your sample size or event rates. So the final, everything, whatever I'm telling will be reflected in the final certainty of evidence evaluation through grade. So always look at the grade for any systematic review using observational studies or RCTs, or whether they have used pair-wise meta-analysis or network meta-analysis, always rely on the grade and see if they've done it properly also. So that's what I wanted to tell, yes.
Thank you, Dr. Veera. This is complex leak plot. So this is basically network estimates where you compare each 14 intervention against each other. It is simple to interpret the vertical and horizontal. So like intratracheal budesonide, if you want to compare, let's say, with a early onset, early initiative fluticasone. So this is the estimate 0.99. And again, you have to see the credibility interval, which is 0.67 to 1.42, crossing the line of no difference. So both, nobody is superior. So this is just to give a overview of leak plot. Dr. Veera, anything more you want to talk about leak plot, or shall we move on?
Yes, so it depends upon the software that you use. They might even depict network meta-analysis with the matrix plot. So, I mean, the interpretation is going to be the same. It might be a leak plot like this one, or it might be a matrix plot. So basically, you are just comparing the treatment versus comparator, and everything comes in one figure. Yes, Javed.
So this is the secondary outcome.
Sorry, Dr. Javed.
There are not many secondary outcome, and we are not going to bore everybody with all the outcomes. So this is BPD. Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah, I think it's better. Yeah.
Audible?
Yeah, continue now. Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Just one second. Where was I? So we will only discuss the outcome which are clinically relevant. So this is BPD at 36 week. EMA. Here you can see two, three things I would like to draw your attention. Early hydrocortisone, this is line of no difference. This favor the intervention, this favor the placebo. Early hydrocortisone is touching the line of no difference. Things which are very effective are, most effective is intratracheal budesonide. Then MOMDX, MOSDX, as well as LA, late initiated high dose dexamethasone, and early initiated budesonide. So the early hydrocortisone show a pattern of lesser incidence of BPD. However, it has not reached a statistical significance. So RR was 0.86, and credible interval was just touching the line of no difference, 1.02. Dr. Veera, any comments on this one?
Yes. So what we have assessed is a competing outcome of BPD or mortality. So both are competing outcomes. So if your babies die early, their BPD rates in that group will be much lesser. So it's quite simple. In neonatology, we always use competing outcomes or combined outcomes. Death or severe neurodevelopmental disability for seeing long-term outcomes. So in similar case, you have to see both of them. So early hydrocortisone decreased the risk of combined outcome of mortality or BPD. But if you see this slide, you can see that it might not be decreasing the risk of BPD. So why is the combined outcome of BPD or mortality low in early hydrocortisone? That is why the reason why it might be so is that early hydrocortisone might be giving a survival advantage. That is, might be decreasing the risk of mortality rather than BPD in decreasing the overall combined outcome of mortality or BPD. This is one of the most important reasons why American Academy of Pediatrics or Canadian Pediatric Society, they advise early hydrocortisone, low dose hydrocortisone in neonates who are at highest risk of mortality, especially those who are born at less than 28 weeks with history of chorioamnionitis in the mother. Yes, Javed.
Thank you, doctor. The other thing which reduces the mortality, as we say, MOMDS, which is moderately early initiated medium dose dexamethasone, the RR is 0.543, which is almost half, and early hydrocortisone, both are moderate grade. This is grade is low and this is moderate, whereas associated with the reduced mortality before discharge. Early inhaled budesonide decreases the incidence of BPD, grade is moderate. Early inhaled budesonide does not show any significant difference in the incidence of mortality compared to the placebo. So, Dr. Veera, is it contradictory or is it in sync with the, is it in sync?
So, yes. So this is the inverse of what we discussed about early hydrocortisone. So budesonide decreased the risk of BPD, but it did not decrease the risk of either the combined outcome of BPD or mortality or the outcome of mortality. So indirectly, what does it signify? That there might be a chance that budesonide results in more deaths, early budesonide. This is precisely the reason why Canadian Pediatric Society, they had advised against the use of early inhaled budesonide. This was also reflected in the larger study by Batchelor, the multicenter European trial on early budesonide. There are conflicting systematic reviews on this. Some reviews which have been published in Pediatrics and all, they are saying that does not cause. Some say it causes, but if you see the certainty of evidence for this particular aspect, it is moderate. When you have a moderate certainty of evidence, your true value, whatever you are showing in this slide, might be closer to what is the reality. Based on this, I can tell you that we were all blinded to CPS guidelines, because CPS guidelines came just when we submitted our paper for review. And we were quite surprised to see that they have given a strong recommendation to not to use early budesonide. And whatever our findings were, correlated quite well with Canadian Pediatric Society guidelines. So the combined outcome was not decreased, but BPD alone was decreased. It might be just because more babies are dying in the budesonide group. So don't use early inhaled budesonide because you have a moderate recommendation from a guideline body. Yes.
Great. Thank you. So the important thing is that none of the intervention are associated with increase or decrease the risk of neurodevelopment impairment. Now, late high dose into 24 months compared with the late initiation of moderate dose dexamethasone. The grade is low, and see the credibility interval is very wide, though significant, 0.03 to 0.90. Dr. Veera, is it not very controversial? Are you not promoting high dose dexamethasone?
So the main thing is, what is the study that had compared this? This study is by Cummings et al. In 1989. First thing. Second thing is, second aspect that you have to see is, what is high dose as per our classification? Anything more than 4 mg per kg cumulative dose is high dose. If you see the individual studies given in table, the characteristics of the studies table, you will see that many of the interventions which were labeled as high dose varied from a dose of as low or as the lowest point being 4 to 5 to as high as 10 to 11. So even studies have used a higher dose of 10 to 11. as clinicians, what you are interested in, you want a particular dose to be divided over a particular period of time. And if I tell you that you use anywhere between 4 to 10 mg per kg of high dose steroids, it's very difficult to interpret those findings. So these are the two reasons. One being this study was done in 1989, the study that you had depicted previously in the forest plot. And the second reason being the fact that the high dose group had a very varied cumulative doses that were grouped together. We can't keep on splitting interventions because that will finally decrease your overall quality of evidence because you won't get any studies to compare. So I hope I'm clear.
Yes, Dr. Veera, it was very complex, but you made it very clear. Thank you. Now again, this is the early hydrocortisone was associated with a high risk of gastrointestinal perforation. The RR is 2.77, and cardiomyopathy is highest with a moderately high dose, moderately initiated high dose dexamethasone. Grade is low. Now this is for the everybody is interested in neurodevelopmental outcome, so. It's a little heavy slide. I'll see the network plot is based on one or two studies only. So if you see, we have used LAMDX, which is late initiated moderate moderate dose dexamethasone, as a comparator. And everything crosses the line of no difference. So there is not much of a difference. Anything you would like to add, Dr. Veera?
It's not, it's not very promising because the certainty of evidence is low to very low for all these interventions and comparisons.
Right.
Because you don't have enough studies evaluating long-term outcomes. From whatever evidence we have, they all seem to be safe.
Right. So there are sparse nodal plot, very few study. Now we did a sensitivity analysis. We removed the high risk of, study with a high risk of bias, and the result were almost same. The medium, moderately early initiated medium dose dexamethasone was still highest ranking, but the Sucra was 0.82, which was earlier 0.91. However, it's still the rank one. When we removed the RCT with a non-invasive respiratory support, the outcome was almost same. When you remove the RCT with antenatal steroid coverage less than 70%, only intratracheal budesonide show a significant decrease in incidence of primary outcome. So RR was 0.64 with CRI of 0.44 to 0.89. Dr. Veera, any comment on this?
So sensitivity analysis are all post hoc and they are prone for bias. So always read them with a pinch of salt. I thought you will be showing a slide regarding intransitivity. It would be much easier to explain.
Okay.
Then we can discuss about this later. Okay. Yes. So previously we had discussed about inconsistency, that is the mismatch between direct and indirect pair of indirect evidence. How can we avoid it? As previously mentioned, instead of trying to adjust for it after your results have come out, always try to make sure that it does not come. So how will we do that? It is by making sure that you enroll studies which have seen, which have evaluated newborns with similar sickness profile, which would depend upon their gestational age, birth weight, whether they were intubated at the time of randomization or not, and things like that. So make sure that it is very similar to heterogeneity in pairwise meta-analysis. The only thing is in pairwise meta-analysis, you are able to downgrade the evidence, which is not very clear in network meta-analysis. What they say is you have inconsistency, then your estimates are quite in doubt. So make sure that you make your characteristics of the included studies table or the studies that you are initially evaluating. See for the patient characteristics. C for the intervention, C for the comparator, C for the outcome. They all should be uniform. A typical example in outcomes, you are studying BPD at 36 weeks and they are including a study which had seen BPD at 28 days. then there is a very good chance that you will have inconsistency detected in your analysis secondary to intransitivity. So like the slide before that Javed showed, the intransitivity phenomenon, which is given in the Cochrane handbook. Javed, can you show that slide? Javed? Yes, so basically the idea is don't mix apples and oranges. Yeah, this one.
The previous
so
one.
This is given in Cochrane handbook. So
this
you
one?
Have, yes, you have different types of, different patients with the previous one, Javed. Javed, the previous one. Yeah, this one. So this is an example of a network plot where they have compared four chemotherapy regimens. Mm. And where this phenomenon, that is you are mixing apples and oranges, that is violated. So you have some patients with stage one disease and you have some patients with stage two disease and you are trying to infer which treatment is better. Obviously, there will be inconsistency in your statistical analysis. Try to avoid it. Don't include those patients with stage two. Just analyze the interventions with stage one patients alone. Similarly, in this, considering this study, you have the mean age of the newborns that were included were around 26 weeks. So obviously they are all kind of very sick with a standard deviation of one week approximately. So gestational age was almost similar. But where we had an issue was whether these patients were ventilated at the time of randomization or whether they were not. So there were some studies that had included babies who were in non-invasive ventilation. No one actually gives steroids for babies on non-invasive ventilation. So we had to exclude those studies in our sensitivity analysis. Second point where you can have inconsistency is when you have very low quality studies with a high risk of bias. They might have results that are quite deviant or not reliable. Then you I exclude them and see for those studies. Again, I would like to emphasize that these are all post hoc analysis. And you remove all your studies, this can result in not only in bias, it can also result in lowering your overall grade because you have less number of studies and less number of patients. Yes, thanks, Javed.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you for explaining this thing. Now, here what we did, we combined all sort of inhaled steroid as early initiated inhaled steroid, which was a sort of a decreased risk of primary outcome when compared with the placebo. The RR was 0.81. And CRI was 0.694. This we have discussed. Now, shall we move on?
Yeah, so Dr. Javed, because I mean, the time is ticking, it's coming to 6 o'clock. If you can go through the salient slide and then the summary, I think translation into clinical practice, that is, I think, what most of us will be keen to know, you know, what exactly we should do. And then we can take some few more questions, answers, I think, at the end. So we have 10 more minutes we can allot, yeah?
So I'll just quickly go through without much of discussion. So here we have divided, now we know that early steroid not to be used. And we know the dose of a steroid should be around medium dose is okay. And moderately early initiated is quite acceptable. Now, what is whether we should give a long course, short course, or medium course? So we have divided the intervention as short course when it is less than 7 days, and 7 to 10 days is medium course, and more than 10 days is long course. So here you can see the things which work here is moderately early initiated high dose, long course dexamethasone, and moderately early initiated medium dose, short course dexamethasone. This is better than the previous one. So MOMDX, which is moderately early initiated medium dose short course, is the best Sukra ranking of 0.82. Now strength, like we have excluded the early early use of steroids, and we have reported all the clinical outcome and all sort of steroids inhaled, all form of preparation of steroids we have, and we have done an exhaustive search strategy. So we could not exclude, you know, the safety outcome, especially of the network plot for neurodevelopmental outcome was because low quality to very low quality because of a sparse clinical trial. So the discussion, I'll quickly go through that Canadian Pediatric Society, which has came out with in a dose of 0.15 to 0.2 mg for a total duration of 7 to 10 can be used for the baby who require invasive mechanical ventilation after the first week of life. So what they are talking about is 1.5 to 2 mg per kg, which as per us is low dose steroid. Our finding is that moderately early initiated, medium dose steroids are safer. However, I would like to point out our quality is low, which is a polite way of saying that true effect may be substantially different from the estimated outcome. Dr. Veera, anything you want to add here?
I think you discussed quite extensively this grade. Right. So I think we can move on because we have time constraints.
And the sensitivity analysis of moderately early initiated medium dose and short course of systemic steroids might be best intervention, which is in sync with the European guidelines. Early hydrocortisone has a mortality benefit. Intratracheal budesonide is beneficial, and it is in sync with the pairwise meta-analysis. Early initiated budesonides, though decrease the incidence of BPD, there is a concern about the mortality because it does not decreases the combined outcome. The long-term outcome, the grade is very low, so please take it with a pinch of a salt. And late initiated hydrodexamethasone, this study is based on the study which is done 3 decades ago. So overall quality is very low. So just quickly, this article is also shared with an editorial comment by Nehal Parekh, who was a reviewer also. And he has referred to this famous article by Doyle Lex in 2014, Journal of Pediatric, where by meta-regression, they have come out with a risk stratification. So on the x-axis, you will see the CLD risk in the control group. And this is favor the nothing, means control, and this favor the steroids. So when your risk of BPD increases more than 50%, it favor the corticosteroids. To be more precise, if your risk of BPD is more than 60%, it favor the steroids. So now coming to the take-home message, I'll quickly wind up. Moderately early initiated medium dose short course dexamethasone may be most appropriate for preventing the risk of BPD. The low quality evidence, early hydrocortisone in higher risk group has a survival advantage, it's moderate quality. Inhaled steroids, the controversy we discussed. Intratracheal budesonide, low quality of evidence to suggest is useful. If you're using early inhaled corticosteroids, fluticasone is probably better than budesonide. So this is the final slide. So this is a disclaimer. I just tried to point out that though systematic review and meta-analysis are the apex of the evidence-based medicine, but they are based on the clinical study RCT done. So the quality, how good or bad they are, entirely depend on how good or bad the RCTs are. So here our grade of recommendation is low. And we propose that this should be confirmed in a better powered RCT. Dr. Veera, anything you'd like to add?
Yes, so low quality, that terminology has been changed now. Now we are using low certainty. So right. When we use low quality, they might think the paper is of low quality, but we got it into JAMA Pediatrics. So it's presently people label it as certainty of evidence, or AHA has a different way of labeling it. Yeah. The American Heart Association, they call it level of evidence. So that is one. Second thing is what we are suggesting for an RCT is not with a placebo arm. If you see the DART trial that was prematurely stopped because you had excessive good outcomes in the arm which received dexamethasone. Similarly, the mini dex trial was stopped because the placebo arm had a bad, I mean, they did not, they fared much lesser in when the data safety monitoring board analyzed the intermittent results. So what we have suggested is you compare moderately early initiated low dose versus moderately early initiated medium dose or with a high dose. So do an RCT like that, which is adequately powered. That was the main point that came out of this paper. And certain quality of evidence or certainty of evidence for certain findings like not to use early budesonide or to use early hydrocortisone, they were all moderate and they are all things that you can take home as well. So, yes. Thanks, Javed.
Thank you, Dr. Veera, for participating. Shall we open the forum for questions?
Yes, there are some questions coming up. First of all, fantastic work and congratulate both of you and whole team who has put up this network meta-analysis. It's a huge task, I can see. Even going through it was such a big task. And this was, I think, just to give flavor of what a network meta-analysis is and, you know, what it looks like. And although, Veera, I was fortunate to do a couple of NMAs with you, but I still feel, you know, there's a lot of uncertainty about understanding the certainty of the evidence. So I think you've done wonderful, you know, job, both of you, to cover up, you know, understanding of these Sukra graphs and network plots and everything. But I'm sure, I think there's more to learn from NMA. So there are a few questions have come up. Dr. Nasir has asked about the software we use, you know, about which is the, what tool you're using for network meta-analysis. So Veera, you can talk about the R software. The graphical illustrations in the slide are auto-generated after using certain software tool. So which tool you are using?
Yes, Nasir, thanks for the question. If you are very well off and you have got lots of money, go for Stata. we are not quite fortunate. So we use the free version, the R software, which is an open software. It's quite strong, but it's not user friendly. That is the main issue with R. R is quite complex. People who write, all these, commands and all, they are quite adept in doing it. Core statisticians, they prefer for R. But as clinicians who do statistics, Stata will be better. If you can learn R, it will take a long time and it's quite frustrating. Go for R. In R particularly, you can use the packages Bugsnet or Gemtec, GMTC. So both of them you can use. These diagrams specifically came from Bugsnet because Bugsnet is tailored for producing publication-worthy figures. I hope that answers the question.
Yes, certainly. Next question, Javed, maybe you can take on. Dr. Yasir Abdullah has said, for primary studies used, what years did you choose? Because time and practice are changing and also the risk of BPD are changing. So if you can just again go mention what years were like included for the studies.
Dr. Yasir, thank you. This question, we have done the entire comprehensive study, all the study, and then we did a sensitivity analysis also. So unfortunately, you can see the studies are very old, some of them, and that is the reason for downgrading the evidence. I hope that answered the question.
Sorry, your voice was muffled. So can you summarize what years we followed? And
we have done the search from the inception till 2020.
Everything is included, but older
included.
You have downgraded because of the...
Exactly.
Yeah. Perfect. That makes sense. Dr. Amit has also asked one more question. What exact mechanism of the drug we are looking for BPD intervention? Why we have to resort to mainly steroids for this? And why not something more narrow spectrum in mechanism? So is it possible we can have different mechanisms of BPD intervention into one network meta-analysis? So steroid, also you have already got 14 intervention, but suppose 14 interventions of steroid and some other interventions like ventilation, whether that can be combined or, you know, that raises the question. So would you like to answer one of you?
Yes. So that's a very good question. First of all, we have so many interventions that are directed decreasing the risk of BPD or CLD. There are two types of reviews. You have a systematic review with network meta-analysis and you have an umbrella review. So when you have competing interventions, that is interventions like steroids are competing, you start one, you won't be starting the other steroid in the same baby. So these are called competing interventions. They are always better analyzed with network meta-analysis. Where you have other interventions that are not competing, but you give along, which work in conjunction or which work synergistically. For example, caffeine versus steroids. You want to combine the efficacy or you want to know which one is better. Now, you can't use a network meta-analysis. You have to use an umbrella review. And an umbrella review on CLD, we have finished it presently. Dr. Abhiram Latha from Chennai is the lead author. Okay. Hopefully, we'll be able to publish it in a very good journal. And,
okay. Yeah. I thought so. You might be already onto it. Just okay, one more question, one comment from Dr. Monica Kaushal. I think understanding itself is a task, and I think we all will agree with that. So requesting some classes, but I think yes, we need probably some systematic ways of training people for doing network meta analysis. And one more question from Prashant RR to everyone. RCT with steroids coverage less than 70% were excluded from this meta analysis. What was the reason behind this? Does it affect the implications for this for us in LMIC, low middle income countries?
You want me to answer, sir? Or?
Yeah.
So that was a sensitivity analysis. It was not a primary analysis. Sensitivity analysis, we have excluded studies with less than 70% of anti-inflammatory steroid coverage. For LMIC, many of these things might not be relevant for you because we don't care for 22, 23, 24 weekers. We might be caring for babies who are more than 25 weekers who might not even be intubated by day 7 of life. But if at all you have a baby who is intubated beyond 7 days of life, you can obviously use this as a guide or can use the Canadian Pediatric Society recommendation. So it is a sensitivity analysis. It is not a primary analysis. So this holds good for us as well.
Sure. I hope that answers the question. So yeah, we haven't excluded everything, just the sensitivity analysis studies were excluded. So looks like we have answered most of the question. And I think this was a very practical sort of, everyone has these questions all the time, which steroids to use, what to use. Definitely we can stay away from the inert budesonide and no wonder we don't see this practice, taking up. And dexamethasone still also, looking like still a promising agent. And about the long-term developmental outcome, you said at least there are no adverse outcomes have shown and the data is not enough, isn't it, to conclude? So we should with using dexamethasone. Which often in the discussions, a lot of time, as you rightly mentioned, there will be two group of people who will be focused on cerebral palsy and all the risk of developmental outcome, and the other group who wants to get the baby off a ventilator and try to prevent BPD. So I think it's a fine balance, and I think you guys really nicely covered that topic. So looks like any other questions, any final comments or words from both David and Veera?
I saw Monica Madam's comments. It would be, I think I'm very sure that she would be able to do it very easily because I read some of their very high quality systematic reviews, the recent one on bevacizumab, long-term outcomes.
Yes.
And I'm very sure ma'am can employ a statistician in Dubai, which we cannot, unfortunately. So that would ease the process a bit. I would like to thank Kiran sir for inviting me. The first few papers we did together, I'm very sure sir remembers those papers on non-invasive respiratory support. And we have worked on other protocol or clinical practice guidelines as well, which are yet to come, which will come in future. And I would like to thank Javed for giving a wonderful presentation on this topic. It's always difficult to present a network meta-analysis and make sure that the audience don't sleep or get confused and frustrated. And he was quite good in going through the slides and explaining to them what they were. And he was a wonderful colleague to work with. And we have many more projects. We hope we can do so many things, address many unanswered questions in the field of neonatology. And thanks, sir. Thank you, Javed. Over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Veera, for having me in this. It was a privilege to work with you and Dr. Kiran. Thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to present this work. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for participating also.
Perfect. And thanks, everyone. I think patiently staying for 1 hour and 15 minutes, I think really amazing. A good discussion. Maybe we need more sessions. We might come up with another session on network meta-analysis just to cover up this topic and create some better understanding on this. Okay, so thanks a lot again, Javed and Veera, and thanks everyone who has joined. We'll see you again in the next session, okay? Thank you and good evening.
Thanks.
Bye. Bye-bye.